This tutorial will show how to utilize the floor vibrations feature to determine the vibration response of steel-framed floors modeled using the finite element method. This capability allows engineers to quickly and easily apply the procedures described in Chapter 7 of the AISC Design Guide 11, utilizing the frequency response function, or FRF, for dominant modes. This will automatically determine the magnitudes of accelerations at specific locations on a floor due to human-induced loads, such as walking footsteps, shown here as a pulse loading, which can then be compared to suggested limits for human comfort, such as these recommended in the guide. Results are generated for two responses: a resonant response that occurs below 9 Hz, and a non-resonant response that occurs at higher frequencies above 9 Hz. It is the resonant response in the sub-9 Hz region that is typically of most interest, as this is the response that humans most readily perceive, with responses in the 4 to 8 Hz range having the lowest threshold for discomfort. The high-frequency response typically is of much less concern, as it is usually less perceptible. The suggested tolerance limits for walking-induced floor vibrations are as shown here. Evidence has shown that the responses are typically dominated by a single mode, and thus the analysis can be simplified by identifying the dominant modes in each frequency range. This is done internally by running a steady-state analysis whereby the model is subjected at the excitation location to a forcing function that varies over a range of frequencies. The modes responsible for the peak accelerations at the response location for both the low and high frequencies are then identified, and it is these modes that are used to calculate the frequency response function FRF and ultimately the acceleration. The model we will use in this example is a 30-foot by 40-foot steel frame floor, consisting of steel girders and joists and a concrete slab. The floor models used in vibration studies typically need only to include a few bays around the bay that is excited by human loading. In this example, we will apply the excitation to joint 26 and look to extract the response at joint 33. The analysis used in this procedure to determine the vibration response utilizes eigenvalues and modes, so we will start by checking our modal case. Going to load cases and selecting the modal case, we can see that it is set to eigen and 20 modes should be more than adequate to capture modes up through the recommended 20 Hz. The next thing we will check will be the mass source. Because we are interested in vertical accelerations, make sure to include vertical mass. For this case, we can also uncheck the lateral mass. The last thing to review before setting up the floor vibration case is to check the steady state function. The floor vibration automated in the program relies on a steady state analysis and utilizes a steady state function here called UniFSS. To set up the floor vibration analysis, we go to the Define Floor Vibrations Excitation Sets command and add a new set. We will name the set Auto Floor Vibration. With an excitation type of walking. As previously stated, the excitation joint will be 26 and the response joint will be 33. The function will be the UNI-FSS as discussed, and the modes will be determined using the modal load case. The damping value used can have an enormous impact on the vibration response and thus should be carefully considered. It may be wise to run the analysis with several different damping levels to envelope responses. The damping here is input in terms of hysteretic damping, which is twice the value of viscous damping. We wish to use a viscous damping of 2%, so we'll input a value of 0.04. The final input on this form is the last frequency. We will leave the default value at 20 Hz, as this should be more than adequate to capture the high frequency response. We can now run the analysis. Before reviewing the vibration results, we will take a quick look at the table of modes. Note that only two modes exist below the 9 Hz cutoff. To review the results, we go to the display, Floor Vibration Results, Walking Vibration Command. On the Walking Vibration Analysis form, we can select the floor occupancy type. We will use offices and residences. We can also adjust the pedestrian weight, if necessary, although 168 pounds is the typical recommended weight. In the analysis summary area, note that two sets of responses have been calculated, one for the low frequency case, 6.866 Hz or mode 2, and one for the high frequency case, 15.398 Hz or mode 7. The corresponding accelerations are shown as a function of the frequency on the FRF plot tab. Note that the high frequency acceleration is higher, but because the comfort limit is also higher, the demand capacity ratio is lower. This is illustrated on the comfort limits plot. Remember these frequency response function values for a later comparison to a hand calculation. Now let's take a look at the computations that are done internally by the program to arrive at the low frequency response. The steps taken are as follows. 1. Run a steady state analysis loading joint 26. 2. Determine the dominant mode and response at joint 33. And 3. Input the response into the formulas from the design guide to determine vibration accelerations. To be able to run the steady state analysis, we need to first define a load pattern so that we can apply our excitation load. And then apply a unit load at our excitation joint, joint 26. Next, we define a steady-state load case. The load pattern applied will be the joint 26 pattern just defined. With the UniFSS function previously discussed. The frequency range will be set from 0 to 20. With two frequency increments. For additional frequencies, we will select the modal case and add these frequencies, as well as some additional fractional deviations. Lastly, we will set the hysteretic damping to be 0.04 to give us the same 2% viscous damping. We can now run the analysis. We can now plot the acceleration response at joint 33, our response joint, by going to the Display Plot Functions command. If we set the end frequency to be 9 Hz so that only the low frequency responses are plotted, we see that the dominant response occurs at 6.866 Hz. If we plot all modes, that is 0 to 20 Hz, we can see that the dominant response in the high frequency range occurs at 15.398 Hz. If we return to the walking vibration analysis form, we see that the steady state values we just displayed match exactly what the automated floor vibration analysis used. Returning to the resonant frequency range, that is less than 9 Hz, we can use the response from the dominant frequency of 6.866 Hz and enter it into the equations from the design guide to determine the acceleration due to walking at the response location. The peak acceleration is approximated as shown here. The FRF max for the 6.866 Hz mode is 164.997 inches per second squared for a 1 kip load, or 0.164997 for a 1 pound load. Converting FRF max into percentage G per pound, we get the following value. Returning to the walking vibration analysis form, we again see that the FRF max value calculated of 0.0427 matches that determined by the program. The next term in the equation is alpha, a dynamic coefficient. It is calculated using the dominant frequency 6.866 Hz. The next term, Q, is simply the body weight, which in this example is 168 pounds. The last factor in the equation is rho. The beta in the equation is the viscous damping, which is half the hysteretic damping, or 0.02. Putting all of the terms into the equation, we get the peak acceleration as follows. Taking one last look at the walking vibration analysis form, we see that again the hand calculated value matches the value automatically determined by the program. And in this case, the floor response is acceptable based on the comfort limit of 0.5. This concludes this tutorial on the use of ETABS automated floor vibrations command.